Yeah, I got into R2 building in 2007. It was between Christmas and New Year. I was looking for something to do. I already built remote-controlled cars, planes, boats, and so on.
I think Star Wars was on the TV at the time, and I just said to my partner, hey, wouldn't it be cool if we could build or buy an R2-D2 and have it in the corner of the room? And she sort of, as usual with me, it's, yeah, you know, another crazy idea. And I found on Facebook there was a builders club. So I joined that, and the first person to add me as a friend from that was a chap called Oliver Steeples.
So to cut a long story short, I've been doing like engineering for 4 years and then gone into an IT job, and I needed something to sort of keep me handy.
But I was out on a golf course playing golf and sort of undulating hilly kind of course, and a guy kind of appeared from behind one hill and was wandering along with his golf club and was being followed by one of these electric golf buggies, you know, just the golf bag and a couple of wheels. And I was like, to my mate, you know, it looks like R2-D2. And we were like, 190 yards and all that kind of, just mucking around. And when I got back, I was kind of knackered and just started searching on the internet and for R2-D2s.
And originally I wanted to build a pit droid, but there were no pit droids around, and I sort of like looking around, found the R2 Builders group. Prior to that, I'd actually been in Robot Wars, first three series of Robot Wars in the UK. And I did a electromechanical engineering degree.
I did electronics A-level. I've always kind of enjoyed tinkering with stuff and fixing bits and bobs. I made a man in a cage, fancy dress costume. So you're kind of being carried by a gorilla. So the gorilla's kind of doing that, and you're kind of sat there in the cage, and it's your legs are the gorilla's legs.
What we do within my work, and it's recycling, we get a lot of electronics in. I wanted to build something, and it just happened in this case to be R2Q5, which has spun the wrong way around for some reason. Let's move him around. There we go. Apologies.
So when sort of like group started, all we had access to was screenshots from original films and the occasional exhibition.
It was a very different environment. You know, it was a case of waiting for the parts to become available, and then you were basically having to fix the parts together, but there was no kind of set course.
So as the group's gone on, the plans have become more accurate, and you get closer and closer to like a screen use droid, and sort of very recently we've had incredible access to some of the original droids, which have resulted in a brand new set of plans which are called sort of CSR, which is sort of club spec revised.
I was a bit more fortunate because I was after Oliver started his build, so astromech.net had been established by then. It was a Yahoo group as well, a forum, and they had a lot of plans and a lot of guides on how to build parts and how you could get hold of parts. So as the group had moved forward a lot more, I had good access to plans for people to view online.
First kind of inkling into what to do or how to build this thing is choosing your materials. A lot of people make framing out of styrene, wood, aluminium, lots of different types of materials. In my case, I went with wood because I kind of figured that wood was going to be an easy material for me personally to work with, rather than you know, things like aluminium and plastic. The great thing about working at a recycling centre is that a lot of the people that I work with know that I'm building things like this. So today's offerings have been wheels, which looks like it's off some sort of cart of some sort, which could be used for maybe a front wheel or a stabilisation element. And the other part is this lifting device, which has come out of a piece of medical equipment, which could be used for perhaps something in the dome to lift parts out of the dome pies.
I was going to build a wooden frame to hold it all together, to hang everything off that's hidden behind the skins. But eventually I went for a styrene material, what's it called?
Cintra.
The ANA Cintra, which is a plastic, because it was something I could just buy. It was laser cut and it was a lot easier. I wanted to spend a lot more time on the other components that you could see, building that myself. Then the legs and the dome, I had aluminium on my R2-D2, mainly for strength, especially with the legs, because they take a lot of knocking. So I decided that aluminium was probably a good tough material to use, as it was getting bashed about so much. So I've got quite a mixture of materials, and it's still going strong now, so I feel it's a good mixture of materials.
You know, I've built a PhD and he is all alley and he is a pretty boy. But he is one of the least practical objects I've ever owned. He weighs an absolute ton. He's completely unforgiving. You don't want to scratch him because it does mark permanently if you do scratch him. He's just a nightmare. And yet, something that was made of styrene and I could just touch up with a lick of paint or whatever would be a joy and weigh half the amount.
So what I've been able to do is, with the assistance of some of the materials within the recycling companies, I've been able to take some of the raw materials and actually use them on the droid. So these parts here, which are aluminium, they're 30mm aluminium hubs. We had those machined out specially. Also, on this aluminium part here, this was all recycled material as well, as was this part here. Been quite fortunate in regards to having bits and pieces available to me like that. And also a lot of the cabling internally has been recovered from other electronics.
So my R2-D2 has a aluminium legs, feet and dome. And this R5 is resin parts with just majority of it is just styrene sheet.
You kind of start building, and if you start from somewhere like I did, you've got almost zero tools, zero skills, and just a drive that you've got to get it done.
Q5 was not an easy build, and it's my first build, and I think there's a lot of lessons to be learned from processes and the way that I did things. In some respects, even maybe rushed a few things, and I wish I'd sort of taken a little bit more time or put a bit more effort into certain things.
Well, BHD was cut in the garden with the jigsaw. I just bought sheets of aluminium from eBay and started hacking it out. And because I didn't want to make mistakes, I made it too big and then filed it back slowly. So it took weeks to get the pieces down. But as I've got, more experience with the hobby, I've made friends that can do jobs for me and I can do bits of electronics for them and stuff. And I've built up my skill set and they've built up theirs. And you're always dipping into different areas with research and, more often than not, you end up with a new tool to do the job easier. And next time you can use that tool to do something else that you've done. And it slowly, progressively gets easier.
I would say the second droid is a lot easier than the first droid, and the third droid's a lot easier than the second droid. So as you go on, what pitfalls you fall into, and you avoid them. As you do events, you actually work out what goes wrong with your droid as well.
There's one particular moment where the robot was on two-leg form, because I had this idea that two legs was going to be a better way of doing it than three, and it actually fell over and smashed the dome to bits. Going through that was an absolute nightmare. Sort of hands on the head, oh my god, is this game over for my droid building time? And I think if I'd really sort of done some serious damage to him, I probably would have ended it there and then. It's a building something like this is a real challenge, and there's been moments where I thought I'm going to just have to walk away from this and end it there and then, and then there's other times where I thought, you walk into the room and go, I've got an R2-D2 in my front room, or an R2-Q5 in my room, and that that for me is pretty damn awesome.
So my R2, because I was very forefront of buying parts, I had to wait for a lot of parts runs. So I started buying parts around 2002, and it was 95% completed for Celebration Europe in 2007, so 5 years of building.
It took me nearly 5 years to collect all the parts for BHD, whereas when I decided I wanted to build X2, I think it was probably around 18 months, 2 years of part collecting, and then, probably a year, 15 months of building. Whereas when I decided I wanted to build Juice, I know I'm making a lot of the structural elements myself and cutting them with styrene and whatnot, but I was able to buy almost the entire droid within 2 or 3 months. All of the aluminium details I wanted, were available to buy. It's just a completely different club than it was when I started.
My one was 2 years. I researched over the Christmas, as I've previously said, in 2007, and I finished it in January 2009. So, including the research, buying ready-made parts in, and building it was 2 years.
Yeah. You know, I think the total amount of time has been around about 8 months. A couple of months in sort of development, thinking about what materials I'm going to use and how I'm going to make this, and then it's sort of moved on. But yeah, I mean, apparently, according to a couple of builders, that it's one of the quickest builds that they've seen. Plus, I think my personality of wanting to get things done. I mean, there hasn't really been a day over the last 8 months where I haven't worked on something with this droid. You know, the cuts on the hands and things like that definitely prove that. It's sort of pushed me to my limits. So, you know, working in the front room, working in the kitchen, upsetting my partner, so much so that I've now got my own work shed to create and to carry on the evolution of this build.
My R5 I built in a year, because a lot of work I just did myself, cutting styrene, and that was finished within a year, and I moved as well in that time scale, so really quick.
I've got two Astrobex now at home, and a third I'm building now, as and when I get time, just from so many spare parts that you accumulate over build, you change ideas and you've got multiple castings of things. So that's why a lot of builders seem to end up with more than one droid for some reason, don't they? But my second build was a lot easier because you learn by your mistakes the first time around.
I finished my R2, sort of the end of 2007, and then sort of from doing events, and what you find is everyone at the time was building their first droid wanted R2-D2 because R2-D2 is R2-D2. Everyone wants it. And I was going to events, and it's as a sort of Star Wars fan and a builder, I just find it very dull when you've got six R2s in a row. And they are unique because there's always differences, but I wanted something different. And that's why I sort of decided to build like a red droid because it's so unique.
Well, my personality is to be different, and I like things that are different in my work life and my personal life. And I just felt that a shiny black droid was probably the way forward. Going to Celebration in 2016, you know, there are a sea of R2-D2s. There are a number of other types of droids as well, but the Imperial droid really kind of was the kind of focus for me. You know, my favourite characters were Stormtroopers, Darth Vader. That kind of imagery sort of really appeals to me. And essentially, this was the Q5 droid, was the droid that was on the Death Star 2. And there's a bit of a backstory about him and things like that. But it was, you know, it was one that was cut out of the movie and it was in the extras.
I started going for R2-D2. As I said earlier on, I bought a lot of parts that I never ended up using. And the plan was that anything that was aluminium on the real R2-D2, I would buy as aluminium, and everything else, I would be a good boy, and I would buy the resin or the plastic, or I would make it in some way. And I made the mistake of ordering the radar eye from Google Day Shore in Australia, and it's beautiful. You know, it's all lightened and made on a God knows how many axis CNC machine. It's a beautiful thing, and I couldn't bear to paint it.
Today kind of marks the last sort of day of my phase one of this build, so it's a functioning droid.
Some of us have been doing it more than a decade, and we've seen an awful lot of droids, and we know, you know, easy pitfalls to avoid, and we can avoid a lot of things like, you know, the obvious runaway droid or the obvious fire, just by casting an eye over these droids. So in order to get them onto the PLI and get the PLI for the group as cheaply as possible, we agreed that we would have a quick look at the droids before they went into service, so to speak.
The MOT basically safeguards and ensures me and the public.
We don't want to stop anybody having fun. We just want to make sure that the fun is had safely and that any obvious things that could go wrong are addressed. But we're there as a final catch-all to make sure that, you know, all of their beautiful work doesn't go up in smoke or crash through a stall of, you know, antique Star Wars toys, or run over 3 5-year-olds.
So the great news is Q5 has passed its MOT, so I'm now officially mobile at the R2 Builders Club. Looking forward to attending some of the events for the rest of the year.
It's two hobbies. You know, one hobby is the kind of creative engineering, tinkering, you know, and, you know, all of that kind of mechanical engineering to some degree. And then suddenly you're dealing with the public. You know, you're driving a droid around Q5 kids and stuff, and you know, you're a puppeteer.
The first event you did was Celebration, wasn't it?
Yep,
in London.
Yep, Celebration.
Which is, I don't think you remember it, but that's the first time I met you, because that was 2007. Seven, okay. So that was around the time I was thinking of building an R2, and I met you and saw you on the stand.
And it went downhill from
there. It hasn't turned out too bad. But I was knowing this interview was coming up, I did look and have a look at it, because I keep a log of all the events I do. And up to when I worked on the films, I did just over 40 events with my R2. So not bad going, quite pleased. And I built it, that's the reason I built it, was to do charity events.
I'm down for Legoland, which is coming up, I think, at the end of April. There's a Bletchley Park a sort of science event. There's various other events with, mainly I want to sort of concentrate my efforts around the sort of charity work, rather than just sort of public appearances and things like that. I'd rather, you know, make sure that when I go out and I take this out with me, that we're raising money for a specific cause.
I love Scarborough every year. Scarborough's fun. It's just a nice local event, but lovely guys that organise it. And yeah, it's just a giggle, really.
So I did curries with Oliver, yeah, we both did curries. We used both of our R2s throughout the advert. They switch them every now and again because we just made sure we were ready for the next scene, basically, so there was no hold up. We shared the job, and I think we had quite an even spread, didn't we, of appearances through that advert.
And it was good prep work as well. So I was at Celebration Essen in 2013, and because of two of the German builders, they built a special droid for Celebration. R4CE2, we had backstage passes, so I was backstage and cheekily got speaking to Kathleen Kennedy and mentioned about if any droids for episode 7 get in touch, and that was in Aprilish, and then the 1st of October we sort of started work at Pinewood.
Every day was sort of driving to Pinewood, and you know, you actually wake up in the morning and want to go to work, you know, and you didn't want to leave at the end of the day, or at least I didn't anyway. But and yeah, it's just as amazing as you could imagine.
I think it's something every Star Wars fan aspires to, stop being working on Star Wars, but sort of never thought it would happen. So for Force Awakens, we made several domes, these for X-Wings. So effectively we brought R6 into canon. I just wanted another dome, so we put several like options forward, which are all roughly the same. We put one option, it's like, there you go. We actually got R2KT flown in from the States, which was incredible, and I think that was actually requested by Lucasfilm. And for all the work that R2KT does for sort of Make-A-Wish, and it was incredible to sort of drive her and actually get her into a film.
For Rogue One, we went to Cardington, which is a big, big hangar. And that was where the Rebel base was shot. And we were there for a week, was it? We were there, I think. And it happens quite often, thankfully, where Oliver and I built the R2-D2s, but there are other droids in the films as well, other astromechs, which, thankfully, they allow us to bring other builders' droids in for. So for Rogue One, we had a few builders come along and bring their droids.
A group of droids were put forward, and mine was selected, and I got to go and hang out on Yavin Base. Doesn't get much cooler than that, really. It was never dreamt that there would be an opportunity. And also, yeah, it wasn't. If you'd have told me that they were going to make more Star Wars movies, I would never have assumed that they would even carry forward in those time periods.
Hopefully in the future, we'll continue to bring other builders droids in for the films, which is a nice thing to do, to just to include as many people as we can for all the hard work they've done building their own droids.
You know, that's the dream, really, I think. If you're, you know, this started off for me as a project of building something for my front room, and I get the feeling now this could be so much more given the opportunity. So it is very much going to be about playing the waiting game, putting myself out there, attending events, and possibly being seen by the right people.
I have gone on to stay in the industry now. Oliver left after The Force Awakens, and you went out on a high.
I hit my high, and that was it.
Fair play to you. But now I just loved the industry. It's now my life. My wife would probably agree with that as well. So that's just a supportive family I've got. And yeah, I'm now in my fourth Star Wars film, and it still feels now as though it's a new thing to me, and I still have to pinch myself nearly every day when I go into work.
And this is phase one. Phase two will be automation of the droid, pie domes and bits and pieces lifting up, arms opening and closing and things like that. That's my next part for this particular build.
Anyone looking to build their first droid should definitely join astromech.net. We've got a UK version as well, astromech.info. They're a friendly bunch of guys, happy to help out with anything. If you're local enough, they come round and help you out as well as when you're needed.
There's wikis, there's guides, there's lots of PDFs that people have written, and you can follow 15 different people's ways of doing one specific job.
Yeah, have a look at various build logs, because you have sort of like styrene, wood and aluminium, and depending on what you're happy working with, sort of almost dictates your build. Mm.